Thank you, sir, for your kind introduction. I am a bit nostalgic today because Sam is sitting here. Whatever I learned in rheumatology, the interest comes from him only. I got a great opportunity in my life to work under him for 3 to 5 years in my career. And I learned and my interest grows in rheumatology only from him. And please excuse me if I fumble in my talk. So when I got this topic from my two friends, Krishnanjan and Moina, who are the one of the organizers of this entire conference, I thought quite some time the how to make it. Because it's a vast topic and 20 minutes is very small to justify this topic. At the same time, nobody get geriatric in a single day. 65 definitely an age, but I am talking on those diseases which are usually in the reproductive age group. So to whom I am giving the medication, basically taking the medication from a long period of time, except rheumatoid arthritis, who can come in this geriatric age group. But otherwise, if I find a spondyloarthropathy in this age group, first time, or early detection, or any other thing like pictures of psoriatic arthropathy, so I will think twice whether we are dealing with any paraneoplastic syndrome or not. It may be a lung cancer, which can present like a polyarthritis. So I try to divide two things. One is the patient who is first presenting at this age, what to do on those, and second, who is taking medications for a long period of time, maybe they are reproductive age group, maybe as early as GIA period, and then gradually going to old age, thanks to the treatment, he is getting more and more older and his hepatic and renal functions gradually compromising. So these two things I taken into consideration. My introduction, most likely the largest part of my talk, because after that I will go on the drugs. 65 year old, a doctor by himself, he is an internist, came to my OPD very recently. He told that I am getting a joint pain about 2 to 3 weeks. There was a low grade fever. Initially, I thoroughly investigated for those fevers because I thought it may be a viral example, viral fever, polyarthralgia, polymyalgia along with. But as his internist, he found that this is not likely a viral infection. The investigations are very suggestive of an autoimmune disease. There is some total leukocytic count was less, some anemia was there, ESR is high, more than 70, and CRP was high. He did anti-CCP, it was strongly positive. I got the report more than 508. And rheumatoid factor is also positive. As you know, in an early RA, as per 2011 guideline, EULAR guideline, we can give it a early rheumatoid and we can start treatment. But now he is very much scared of the doses of the DMARDs. How to begin with? Particularly methotrexate. He started with 5 mg per week along with sulfasalazine 500 twice daily, hydroxychloroquine 200 twice daily, and he is very scared of taking steroid at this moment because patient is known diabetic, known hypertensive and known hypothyroid. Just a few minutes back, we discussed so many things on diabetes, heart failure and thyroid. So here lies the problem from the rheumatologist. How to monitor this patient, how to give the drugs, how to increase the drugs. At the same time, how to prevent the drug interactions. Patient is taking ACE inhibitor, patient is taking 2 or 3 OHAs, sometimes insulin. Patient is taking drugs for hypothyroidism as well. So it's a polypharmacy going on. At the same time, we are giving another group of drugs, which is DMARD, in a balanced way, so that his rheumatoid as well as the rheumatoid related complications taken care of. Because we know that atherosclerosis is also increased with rheumatoid. So rheumatoid may be an added risk factor on the cardiovascular system as well. So here is the problem. The large geriatric population, it's increasing day in and day out in India. Most people of old age suffering from different joint diseases. Osteoarthritis most likely the commonest of them. Though I am today on DMARDs and biologics, but osteoarthritis, we need not to forget, is the most common problem of joint disease in geriatric age group. Many of them taking drugs for the joint pain and multiple comorbidities, as I have already discussed, and drug interaction and senile metabolism. Senile metabolism, there is renal as well as hepatic dysfunction. There is gradual reductions of the capability of the liver and kidney. At the same time, if the patient is diabetic, already there is development of diabetic nephropathy. If the patient is sometimes alcoholic, so there is chances of there also there is a development of the non-alcoholic fatty liver disease as well, which can compromise the hepatic function. And as we know, most of the DMARDs have a long half-life. They have usually weeks, sometimes even months of half-life. So that sometimes it happens, patient stop taking DMARDs for a long period of time, remains asymptomatic, and they thought their disease vanishes, which is not true. At the same time, being senile, patient forgets to take medicine. I have got a patient who, instead of taking once weekly, comes with a severe neutropenia, severe anemia, severe thrombocytopenia, because he is taking methotrexate every day. Though it is 5 mg per day, but instead of 5 mg per week, he is taking 5 mg per day. Because of senility, he cannot see properly, though there is cataract surgery as well. So there lies a problem. So now, drugs of my concern, I will keep my concern on the first five area here. And also mostly on DMARDs, glucocorticoids, biologicals, JAK inhibitors, and immunosuppressive therapy. I am not going into the detail of other drugs of my concern, like NSAID, niacin group of drugs, collagen derivatives, calcium, vitamin D, and anti-gout drugs, which is main basket of a rheumatologist. Now, I am going to methotrexate, which is my main drug of anti-rheumatoid therapy. So its mechanism of action, as you know, it's a dihydrofolate reductase inhibitor. It increases release of adenosine. Adenosine, we know from the very early of our school age that adenosine is an anti-inflammatory product. It has a potent inflammatory inhibitor. So basically, methotrexate increases the intracellular adenosine level. So methotrexate polyglutamated in cell, having its prolonged therapeutic effect. Similarly, it takes a long time to act. You may not get the adequate therapeutic benefit of methotrexate up to 3 months of therapy. You will get it after 3 months. In this period, some drugs needs to be given which releases and relieves the patient's pain and discomfort. Rarely, or combined with folic acid, it reduces side effects, but usually we avoid folic acid on the day of methotrexate. It should be given in a given gap. Sometimes on the day of methotrexate therapy, patient may complain some problem like gastritis, like headache. Those patients, you can give just a simple advice: take a strong cup of coffee, because it will causes folic acid reduction, methotrexate reduction of side effects. Methotrexate pneumonitis is a serious disease, and usually we discontinue therapy if there is pneumonitis. Here is also a very tricky area, because most of the patients of geriatric age group can present with a senile ILD type of pattern. They may have basal crepitations on examination, auscultation, and when we did a HSCT thorax, there will be some ground glass hazinesses, opacities. It may be senile, it may be methotrexate induced, or it may be simply the other diseases. Here, we need to do a bronchoscopy to prove it whether we are dealing with a meningitis and pneumonitis. But how many patients we can advise for a simple things for bronchoscopy, which is an invasive procedure, particularly in the elderly group. That is why sometimes we reduce the dose or sometimes we even stop the dose of methotrexate. Methotrexate doses depends on creatine clearance. So usually we begin from 5 to 7.5 mg and we can go up to 20 mg. It's better not to give a geriatric population 20 mg, more than 20 mg. Usually for a reproductive age group, we can go even up to 30 in a obese patient, we can go up to 35, 40 also. But for geriatric group, better to keep within 20 mg. Dose adjustment as per creatinine clearance is between 61 to 80. The reduction will be 25% of the initial dosing. As I have already discussed, these patients usually coming from a long period. Initially, patient may have treated from 35 years of age, and now patient already treated 30 years with DMARDs. So it's better, as per the creatinine clearance, to reduce the dose if the patient is now in geriatric group. And for creatinine clearance 51 to 60, reduction is up to 30%. And from 10 to 50 ml, reduction is up to 80% of the initial dosing. Patients for less than 10 ml is better to avoid, because patient is now in end stage renal disease. And what are the alert? When the patient is taking DMARD along with methotrexate or methotrexate alone, these points are very alarming sign. You need to see and investigate this patient immediately. That is stomatitis, nausea, and evidence of bone marrow suppression. That is why when the patient is coming for follow-up, particularly aged patient, we used to tell them to come for a frequent follow-up. Maybe within 3 months, if the patient is asymptomatic, and if the patient is symptomatic, maybe monthly follow-up is required sometimes. And for that, we used to do some basic tests, particularly liver function test and complete hemoglobin, so that we can diagnose bone marrow suppression early, we can diagnose transaminitis early, along with some disease markers like ESR and CFTR. Now, leflunomide. It's another very important drug for our DMARD basket. It is very potent drug as well. It is a dihydroorotate dehydrogenase inhibitor. Its loading dose previously it was given, that is 100 mg for 3 consecutive days, followed by 10 or 20 mg. But nowadays, loading dose has stopped, because loading dose having a serious GI toxicity. It has an enterohepatic circulation. It has a very long half-life. It's no significant dose adjustment is required in elderly, because it is given 10 mg or 20 mg. But as I have already discussed, that frequent hepatic and hematologic follow-up and investigation is necessary, because there is chances of hepatic enzyme derailment, and it is contraindicated in liver and renal insufficiency. Sulfasalazine, it's a variety use. It's used in almost all sorts of antirheumatic, all sorts of rheumatological diseases except SLE. So it's anti-inflammatory as well as antimicrobial. The dose recommendation is almost same in geriatric as well as non-geriatric population. Its elimination half-life is longer. Dose reduction required in renal insufficiency. And in case of GI intolerance, headache, dizziness and rash, we should think and we should reduce or stop the medication if these symptoms come. Antimalarials, it has again long half-life, no adjustment is required. Usual dose is begin with 3 to 5 mg per kg per day. It can be given 400 mg per day, and for particularly geriatric population, we can go up to 600 mg in case of normal population. The accommodation and converse effects, these are the early ophthalmological symptoms of chloroquine maculopathy. So we should have a periodic checkup for the ophthalmological point of view. And these two things are alert, that is accommodation and conversion defect as well as blood vision. Now, combination. We have discussed individually, but as I discussed in the first case, when to begin, that patient, when that doctor patient comes to me, I have to give relief that patient. So we can start with due respect and due caution of the diabetes and hypertension, we can start low dose steroid in this patient. There is different trials which shows that combination methotrexate, hydroxychloroquine and sulfasalazine with prednisolone in low dose having a very good disease activity remission, at the same time early relief of the symptoms. TR trial is also there, and in this TR trial there is use upon biologicals as compared to the conventional DMARDs. To sum up, combination therapy seems superior in terms of efficacy, having less adverse effect, because when we are giving a combination, we are giving less dose to the individual drugs, so the side effects is a bit less in the elderly population. Corticosteroids is very effective in the early therapy, is used almost all autoimmune diseases to reduce inflammation and disease activity, can be used in early as well as in flare, but we should remember the duration should be short. Maximum 3 months, let methotrexate takes its action. You can give in a tapering dose up to 3 months, and sometimes you can readmission corticosteroids in case of flare. Flare sometimes having any infections or any other problem. In that case, you can give a short-term steroid therapy followed by the conventional DMARDs again to prevent its long-term side effects. Now, biologicals. We come across the rheumatological biologicals. These are infliximab, etanercept, adalimumab, golimumab, sardolimab. Rituximab, that is an anti-CD antibody. Abatacept, tocilizumab is an interleukin 6 inhibitor. And tofacitinib is an oral drug, which is a JAK inhibitor. So let's come one by one. The anti-TNF. Anti-TNF, this is a busy slide. You can see the lower part. The infection is the main concern. Infection is the main concern of this anti-TNF agents in elderly. Otherwise, it can be used safely in patients with rheumatological diseases. Similarly, TNF inhibitor, there is another trial which can show that the retention rate of TNF inhibitor in elderly was comparable. You just read the conclusion, is comparable with that of the younger patients. So, there is retention rate is almost comparable with the elderly as well as in a younger population in case of TNF inhibition. This is the latest one, is a June 14, 2018. It shares that TNF-alpha inhibitors may reduce the need of total hip replacement among the older and more severe rheumatic arthritis patients. Similarly, let's come to the rituximab. Here, more than 1000 patients was taken who are more than 65 years of age, and it's shown that the efficacy and safety of rituximab is affected with age, but mostly infection is the main problem of terminating or reducing therapy of rituximab. Otherwise, it is well tolerated in most of the patients. Similarly, abatacept, the effectiveness of abatacept is not affected by age and increased rate of side effect, especially infection. So, similarly in case of tocilizumab, it seems to be well tolerated in other patients, but is less efficient in elderly patients. A broader field of analysis to include the international register would be required. Tofacitinib, it is an oral drug. The older patient receiving tofacitinib 5 to 10 mg BID had a similar probability of SCR 20 and SCR 50 response, and due to comorbidities and numerically higher risk of adverse effects and discontinuation due to adverse events compared to the younger patients. So all the biologicals, the adverse effects is the main point of reducing or stopping the biologicals. Otherwise, efficacy wise, biologicals are almost equally efficacious in younger patients and older patients as well. And most of the time, infection is the major terminating or reducing factor of biologicals. Now, immunosuppressive. We mostly use immunosuppressive in SLE and other SLE-like diseases like scleroderma, Sjögren, in these areas. So, and if there is methotrexate toxicity. Otherwise, the use of these medications in rheumatoid arthritis is quite less. So, cyclophosphamide, azathioprine, cyclosporine, mycophenolate, and tacrolimus. And here, we need to know that we hardly start these drugs in the beginning of a patient in old age. We mostly give these patients who are in reproductive age group and maintaining the drugs there. So I am just going in a nutshell in this because of time constraint.
So cyclophosphamide is an alkylating cytotoxic. Its active metabolites are alkylating deoxyribonucleic acid. Azathioprine is a purine analog. Cyclosporine is a calcium urine inhibitor, so as tacrolimus. And mycophenolate is a purine synthetic inhibitor. So mostly they act on the nucleus level. This is their way of action, where it acts in calcium urine, and these are the antigen presenting cells and T cell receptor where they used to act and did the main inhibiting effect of the their anti-inflammatory action. I am not going into details in these drugs, but mostly, as in biologicals, these drugs having their main problem is infection and hepatic and renal dysfunction. So I am skipping this. So now comes to my summary. As I have already discussed, all DMARDs are safe in old age, but dose should be adjusted. Mitomycin is the principal DMARD in rheumatoid and should be used with caution in patients with renal compromise. DMARD dose adjustment is necessary in regular intervals. And glucocorticoids can be used for an early therapy for a short duration and thinking of the comorbidities. Therapy with multiple drugs in relatively low doses are more justified as compared to the monotherapy. Biologicals are quite safe in old ages. Infection is a major factor of biological therapy in elderly. Immunosuppressive agents can be used, but close monitoring is necessary. So, our take home is DMARDs and biologicals are safe and effective in old age group. Drugs should be started in low doses and gradual increase up to a certain point. Initial close and frequent monitoring of the patient and blood reports are mandatory. Either stop or reduction of the dose whenever is required in terms of their side effect profile. Thank you.